we need worldwide. Actually, most of the equipment are manufactured by Americans, and they still use FPS system, barrel, gallons, like that. And our the equipment, the tanks, etc., also measured in, calibrated in barrels, not in cubic meter. So SI system is not generally used worldwide, mostly because the manufacturers are Americans. So they calibrate and manufacture the size according to the barrels, gallons, etc. So, okay, so this is how actually you should know how many liters, conversions, factors, gallons. So 1 cubic meter is 6.29 barrel, okay, 159 liters, that you can convert easily. So mostly, as I told you yesterday, that class G cement is API class G cement is used in India, and somewhere else, some countries use class H cement also. Only thing is, class H has a particle size is slightly less, so water requirement is more, so density is also less. See, one sack of cement, is 94 pounds. Now, conventional construction cement come in India in 50 kg bags. Okay, but here the bag is different. Why? Because they have a standardized volume. Volume they take, consider, take one cubic feet volume. So whatever 1 cubic feet, what is the weight of this? 6-inch class G is 94 pounds. So they have kept one this thing unit. Volume is one unit. So 1 cubic feet. So the bulk density of cement slurry is 94 pounds per cubic feet. Okay, because volume is fixed, 1 cubic feet. So 94 pounds is a standard API sack, 94 pounds per cubic foot. Okay, this is bulk density. What is absolute density? Because you have some void spaces depending upon the particle size. Actually, some anything you know, the big flour we use, when you actually shake the container, it gets compacted because the void spaces are occupied the solid particle. But 100% is not this thing. If you have a solid piece like steel, so the bulk density absolute density of steel will be same. But for cement, because it's a ground material, it is actually grounded from the clinkers. So that grounded material that contains some air. So bulk density depends on the particle size. Okay. So now, suppose we actually, the example I have shown, 5.5 inch primary cementation. So you will be drilling, total drill depth is 3,500, I have shown in example, 3,514 meter. Casing shoe depth, actually we slightly keep a shoe slightly above this bottom. Other, if you leave the casing shoe at the bottom, it may choke your shoe port, and you may not establish the circulation. Slightly we keep sump of 2 to 5 meter this thing. And in floaters, we try to keep, because if motion compensator fails, then shoe may get damaged. So in floaters, we keep slightly more this thing sum, and in jack-up rigs or in onshore, we keep 3 to 5 meter sum. So shoe depth is 3,510 meter. Float collar, as I told yesterday, that two joints apart. So it is about 24 meter away. So float collar depth is 3-4 this thing. Now, casing is, why actually we measure the casings, OD size, by OD size casing. All casings and pipes in petroleum industries are measured by OD size. And we, PPF is mentioned. PPF is what? Pounds per foot. Okay. In per foot of length, what is the weight of the pipe? If actually thickness of pipe is more, the weight will go up. So now in 5.5 inch casing, API casing comes in 17 PPF also, 20 PPF and 23 PPF. So the ID of 23 PPF will be minimum, and 20 PPF is medium, and 17 PPF will be, ID will be highest. Okay. And P110 is the grade of the casing. So this actually PPF and the grade is requirement depends upon the your pressures for which actually casing design is done. So based on the bust rating, collapse rating, and the tensile stress, combined load, everything you might have studied in your engineering course. So based on that, casing is designed. So that is designed by drilling engineers. Now we have to lower the casing, and in present case it is 20 ppf, 5.5 in size. So the endless OD I know, OD of the casing I know. So endless dia, if I know the OD, then there will be a overlap between the casing, previous casing. Previous casing will be what? Most likely it will be 9.58 inch. So if I am calculating the cement rise behind casing into the endless also, so I have to consider the volume of 9.58 as well as 5.5 between that annular volume I have to calculate. Now slurry design, it says 100% OWC, oil well cement. OWC, wherever next slides, actually OWC is mentioned, is oil well cement. Oil well cement class G. And 46% water. Water, wherever we add, it is percentage by weight of cement, not blend. Actually, cement may contain some other additives, inert materials also, like we add 30 to 35% silica also when temperature is higher, more than 110 degrees centigrade. A phenomena called strength retrogression, in higher temperatures, more than 110 degrees centigrade, a silica is added into the silica flour or silica core silica. It is added into cement. Then actually the water requirement is calculated only with respect to cement only. And 16% hematite. Hematite is also inert, it is not active. Why hematite is added here? Because we need to have the slurry density higher, because it's a weighting material. Hematite is a iron ore. So density of hematite is more than that of cement. Okay, cement bulk density, I've already told, it is 94 pounds per cubic feet. One sack is per cubic feet. And these are the additive. Dowel is a company. This Dowel is a proprietary additives of Schlumberger. So DO is, DO 60 is fluid loss additive. So 0.8% by weight of cement. All additives except salt or calcium chloride are added by weight of water. All other additives are added by weight of cement. Even hematite is 16%, means suppose I have a one sack of cement, I am preparing a slurry with one sack of cement. So one sack of cement is 94 pounds. So 16% of 94 pound will be 0.16 into 94. So that much of hematite, that by weight, will be added to cement. And 46% water is there. So, and these additives are in very small quantity. So as far as density is concerned, these have a negligible effect. You can see these percentages, 0.8%, 0.1%, 0.1%. So, and because how you calculate the density of the slurry? How you calculate the density of the slurry? Let me, what is happening here? See, I have gone to some other slide. Jump to some other slide. Yeah. Let me check. Now it is okay. This is okay. This. Now, yes. It's not coming. Now, caliper log, I have already explained. This is caliper log. You can see the hole is enlarged. So you need to take the caliper log. I will show you this. This, see left side, this is a portion of caliper log, section of caliper log. As you know, this left side, I'm showing you, this is the bit size. This dotted line, it is showing bit size. And the range is 6 inch to 16 inch. The range is 6 inch to 16 inch. So the hole is, see, bit size is 8.5 inch. So this is actually 6, 7, 8, 8.5. So you can, so it is also written, mentioned here, BS, bit size. Okay. So this is actually hole. This is the hole. The green line is gamma ray. This is gamma ray. And this is maybe some other log, maybe because this is SP, cell potential log. Okay. Spontaneous potential. Okay. You, because number of logs I'll calculate, maybe resistivity log also. And this red line shows the tension of the logging wire. Okay. So you see this blue color, dotted line, blue color, that is the hole size. Okay. So what you do, how you will calculate the volume, caliper volume, how you calculate, you have to divide, because this is actually not a straight line. It is a zigzag line. Hole is erratic. It is not a straight line. Okay. So either you average it out, but it is a very tedious job. Like here, I have done an average 14 inch. This is average 14 inch. This to this, then it is 12 inch. The now, but integrated volume is calculated by computer. Okay, because as caliper arm is opened, it is actually continuously water from bottom to the casing shoe. The caliper is recorded, diameter is recorded. So this you see on top here, this symbol is integrated casing volume. It considers only annulus, whereas this integrated cement volume, this is cement volume. Okay. So this is cement volume. Okay, these dots. The bigger one is 1 cubic meter and it has 10 divisions, small sections. So it is 10, 10. This thing will be this. So I can count this. Okay. So against the cement rise, I can count this. And this is sometimes it is written here also in the log itself. Log in itself, it is calculated and total whole volume is mentioned. But I may not be covering the cement up to the previous casing issue or maybe taking cement inside the shoe. Suppose I am covering only part of the hole in the bottom, say maybe 500 meter. So I am not considering the total hole volume. So only up to the depth, I know suppose the depth is mentioned here. Suppose I want to raise the cement up to 2730. Here it is 2730. So from the bottom, I will calculate the volume only up to here. I will not consider this volume. Will I? No, I will not consider. I will consider the volume here. So I will count this from here. How many this thing marks are coming? See, this actually bigger mark is corresponds to cubic meter, 1 cubic meter. So I can count how many this thing are there from 2732. It is 1, 2, 3. So it is 0.3 up to this 35. So like that, and it will vary the distance. This will vary. I'll show you this. I'll go back and this thing direct. And maybe if I get time, I'll show you the actual log. Of Schlumberger. Okay, here it is clear. Now you can see in the right hand side, I have mentioned here, this is actually length of the different sections and the volume total. Against this length, it is coming 0.4 to this thing. Okay, so like that, total annulus volume can be calculated, which is actually variable depending upon the hole size. Whereas the fixed volume inside, suppose I have to pump the slurry in the shoe track also. Shoe track is what? Distance between the float collar and float shoe, that distance is fixed. Here in my present case, it is 24 point some meter. So 24 point some meter, that I know the capacity of this 20 inch PPF casing, 5.5 inch. So I know the ID, or directly it is capacities are, you know, tables are available in industry where you can find directly see 5.5 inch casing, 20 PPF, what is the ID and what is the capacity volume distance. So you multiply the capacity per meter, you get the volume. So you add up all the volumes. If any overlap, casing overlap is there, that volume plus annular volume, column volume, and inside also. So total volume is calculated. The total slurry volume will come. Okay. See this, this different depth. I have actually mentioned so many meters, so many this thing, hold dia. Whole dia is this. So according to dia, it has been calculated volume. So this volume total, if I'll add up all the volumes, so I'll get total slurry volume. Total slurry volume is coming 600 meter rise in the analysis, 16.4 cubic meter. Okay. So 16.4 cubic meter total slurry volume I'll know. And shoe track also see, shoe track 25 meter casing capacity. So 24 meter, it is 11.6 in my 5.5 capacity, it is 279 liter. So I have this 0.279 to 16.4. So it will be 16.68 cubic meter. Okay, this is the volume, total volume. And some volume will be wasted in my surface lines equipment when I'll be, actually entire volume will not be pumped. Some of the tanks which I'll pay, some will have some dead volume in the tank. Maybe I'll not be able to pump entire volume. Okay, otherwise the pumps will take air and I will not be able to pump. The air will go into the line and there will be a problem. So some extra volume I'll prepare. Suppose I'm getting 16 point required volume is 16.68 cubic meter. I will try to prepare about 20 cubic meter. I will plan for 20 cubic meter. And mixed water, where the chemicals will be added, mixed water. Now I have already explained what is absolute volume and what is bulk volume. Okay, bulk volume I have explained. Okay, one sack is equal to 94 pounds, whereas the absolute density for oil well cement is 3.14 is the specific gravity for absolute density of the the cement. Now, see, it is very simple. What is yield? Yield is for per metric ton or per fixed quantity of the cement, how much volume will be prepared? That is yield. I'll be mixing water in it. Okay, I'll be mixing other additives or chemicals. So per metric ton, what will be the volume of the slurry? Because I am calculating, I am concerned about the volume. Volume I have already calculated. So against that volume, how much cement will be required? For that, I need to know the yield. Okay, how much per metric ton? What is it? So what I am adding to the water? For simple, suppose I am not adding any additive. No hematite, no lightweight additive, no heavyweight additive, no other this thing for controlling fluid loss, friction reducer, no additive is added. It is simple API cement G, class G cement plus water. Then what will be the yield? Okay, simple. I take, say, if in the present example, if you say I take 1 ton of this thing, 1 ton is corresponds to 1,000 kg. Okay. And see, density I have already mentioned. Total mass upon total volume. This is a simple formula. Total mass upon total volume. Okay, is it density? Okay. So if I take it, this thing yield, it will be equal to total volume is how much? Density, I know the absolute density of this cement, I know, and the absolute density of water, I know. Okay. If I add these both, so it will be, because 44% water is added and density of water is 1. So 44% water means, suppose I take 1 ton of cement, 44% will be 440 kg water. So this is water. This is calculation for water. Okay. And density is of water is 1000 kg per cubic meter. So this plus this matlab volume plus this volume will be equal to 0.76 cubic meter per 1 metric ton of this thing. So if I use 1 metric ton of cement, oil well cement, and mix with water, prepare a slurry, yes, because 44% water is added, and then it means 0.76 cubic meter cement slurry will be. This is standard. If I am not adding anything, then it is standard. If I add, then I have to consider those densities also. Okay. The basic principle, total mass upon total volume principle has to apply. You can very well, if you know the densities of absolute densities of different chemicals and their water requirement, you can this thing. Suppose I add salt to a cement slurry, maybe 2% salt. Okay. So for that, I will be only adding salt will be what, where will the salt go? It is actually soluble in water. So it will go into the intermolecular space of water. So in slurry also, though, if volume will not increase, volume increase will be negligible. There will not be any increase in the volume. So water is salt in limited concentration is added. It does not contribute to any addition in volume because salt is soluble. Similarly, calcium chloride is soluble. So all those compounds which are soluble in water, so with that, there will not be any water requirement. It will not be adding to any yield. Okay. But this will contribute because salt has the density. If you are adding 2% salt, so salt has density, it will go into the in the slurry. So that will add to the mass. 2% of by weight of cement water is adding, we should know the density of the salt or calcium chloride. So that density, that mass has to be added. Okay. So this is how calculations are bentonite. Why we add bentonite to the cement slurry? See, it is very simple. If you want to reduce the density, I would say you can add more water, the density will reduce. Right, it is right. But what will happen? If I add more water to the slurry, as I told yesterday, for hydration only 28% of water is required. Rest of this actually, 16% water remains in the matrix and little bit of free water is left, free water. And that should not be more than API says after treatment. See, normal in the neat cement, it is about 5.6%. Whereas actually after some treatment, it should not be more than 1.4%. And for high inclined wells, which I'll be covering tomorrow, in high inclined wells, the water separation should be zero. There should be nil this thing. Okay. I will explain tomorrow why it is should be nil. So by adding more water, I can this thing. But what will happen if I add more water? Water separation will be huge. Whatever extra volume of water I am adding, that will come on top of the cement. Cement will hydrate. On top of that will be a lot of water. So it is detrimental for the well. because my height volume is more, but some of the volume will be without cement. Only water will be there on top of the said cement. So I don't want that condition. So what we actually add, extender. Bentonite you might have studied. Bentonite is sodium montmorillonite, and it is actually it is an extender. It is added in mud also system. It is widely used. Very fine particles, sodium montmorillonite. It is actually added in cement, used in cement slurries also as a filler slurry, not as a main slurry, because that ultimately cement slurry is pumped to achieve strength, compressive strength. So you actually compromise when you add bentonite, compressive strength is compromised by adding bentonite. But actually it reduces the cost, because suppose filler slurry has to be used, I need to cover, say, my zones are in bottom 300 meter and I need to cover cement, say, 800 meter. So what, 500 meter above the main slurry, I will use a gel slurry or the lead slurry. Okay, that they where I may add bentonite, 2%, 3%. Suppose I actually more bentonite I add, okay, so that will be lighter, the slurry will become, because that extra water is absorbed by bentonite. Bentonite swells in the slurry. So extra water, whatever extra water is there, that is absorbed by the bentonite. Okay. So I have already explained, 2% bentonite is added when it is prehydrated. Prehydrated means it is actually mixed with the water and with the water, and it is not soluble, but it is suspended in the water, and then it hydrates, it grows in size, and it absorbs more water. So all these actually water requirement we should know. Like bentonite is a chemical which is added, suppose 2% is I am adding. So how much is the water percentage? This is actually I have mentioned, so that I can know the slurry weight. For 2%, the slurry weight will be specific gravity 1.77, and yield will be more. As we increase the percentage quantity, and because water percentage is increasing, the yield is increasing. You can do your calculations. Okay. You can do it yourself. You should know that, only check the tables. You know the density, total volume, total mass upon total volume will be the density. Okay. For 2%, the density slurry weight is 1.77. In PPG, it is 13.7 pounds per gallon. Okay. This is specific gravity. And now similarly, silica floor, it is added. Okay. Silica floor, there is actually silica floor fine as well as silica floor coarse. As I told you, silica is added for the purpose of strength retrogression, a phenomenon when the bottom hole temperature, static temperature is more than 110 degrees centigrade, a phenomena occurs, strength retrogression, that I will explain tomorrow. Okay. So silica floor is added. Then this is actually water requirement for silica floor, and for coarse silica, there is no water requirement. So the density is actually is different. So this is actually how yield is calculated. You can see the table, water hematite is also added. Okay, for hematite, so these are the additives we have added. This is actually DO60 is fluid loss additive. DO65 is a friction reducer. D121 is a multi-purpose additive, and D047 is defoamer, because when cement is mixed and it sucks some air, so then defoamer is also added. It is very small quantity, 0.1% is added. So as you can see here, the volume it is coming very very this thing. Okay, its additives is very less. You can ignore also, it is negligible at macro level. You can ignore. See this 0.001. So the total yield is coming. So you calculate the total yield per metric ton. So you know how much volume will be per metric ton, it will be prepared. So this is how calculation is done. So we know for 1 metric ton, how much will be the volume. So first we calculate the volume required of the cement slurry. Then we calculate the tonnage of cement, how much cement will be required, and how much quantity, or because percentage of this is fixed. So against the cement, because all the additives are added as a percentage of cement. So we know what actually quantity of all the additives will be required. Okay. So some of the actually blends, we do dry blending. So dry blending is done at the base, and wet blending is done at the site. So at the site, actually in the mixed water, some chemicals are added, that is called wet blending. So, okay. So in this black, dark, this thing I have highlighted it, because it is by weight of cement only. So it is not, see, 21 ton total, if you see 21 ton is oil well cement only plus hematite. So the total weight, if you see in the silo or in the equipment total, it is a dry blend. So how much is the percentage of 16% hematite? So 21 ton plus 16%. So 16% of 21 will be 2.56, it will be coming. So about 2.5 you have to add. So it will be not 2 point, about 3, sorry, 3 point something it will be. So total 24 point some metric ton will be there, cement. Because we have the hematite does not include, this 21 ton does not include the hematite. Because all the additives are in terms of percentage of the cement only, not the blend. So this is very important point, okay. So now this is actually cement and volume. That is again the same calculation has been done. It is shown weight of this thing and specific gravity. Now it is total, what is the slurry density? Total volume, total mass upon total volume. So total volume is coming 0.82. Here you see that I have calculated all this total volume. So the density, this is coming, the slurry density will be 1.99 approximately. It is okay, 1.99 specific gravity. In kg per cubic meter, it is coming 1989. So similarly, it is calculated for all the casings. It is simple, nothing. Now, this is actually calculation for cement, water, and other additives. Now, you have to calculate the displacement volume also. Because you are pumping the cement slurry, that cement slurry has to be displaced. So how much it has to be displaced from the top surface to the float collar? All the slurry which will be here in the casing, that has to be displaced. So how much volume of mud you have to pump to displace it up to here? This actually shoe track will be filled with the cement, and outside also it will be cement. So the total quantity, this volume plus this volume I have already pumped. Now this has to be displaced. So how much volume it has to be displaced? The capacity of the casing into depth up to float collar. Okay, float collar depth is 3486 meter. So that capacity of the casing, okay, that he is calculated about according to ID of the casing. The capacities are available now, and charts are available for 20 ppf. What is this thing? Okay, roughly. So you can, it is, I think, 11.7. I remember this 11.7 to 12 liter per meter is the capacity of 5.5 inch casing. So this is actually calculated 11.6, it is right. For 20 inch, 11.6. And if suppose it is lighter casing, 17 ppf, it will be 12 liter per meter. So this is actually displacement volume. So now we need to displace with 40.44 cubic meter of mud. And after this thing, suppose I am pumping after flush also, after this thing, normally actually in ONGC, we have stopped pumping after flush, because plugs are used in the casing. After flush is only pumped in the plug jobs and squeeze jobs. But here, normally we don't pump this after flush. So we drop the plug and start displacing with this, okay, directly with the mud. But in case you are pumping after flush some water or something, then after flush volume has to be subtracted from this 40.44 cubic meter, because the total capacity of the casing is 40.44 cubic meter. So this much volume of mud is to be pumped, okay. So, if I know the volume is now calculated, I'll maybe in the next slide I'll show. Now, coming to the pressure, what will be the pressure of, okay, nowadays actually we have simulators. So, we run the simulator. I'll show you one slide, last slide, that is actually simulator. Also, we know what will be the anticipated surface pressure during pumping also time. Entire job, this is simulated, because in no case, why we simulate? Because in no case, this your pressure bottom hole or any point should, the pressure at any point in the endless should exceed the fracture gradient, or should be less than the pore pressure. If it is less than the pore pressure, the activity will take place. If it is more than the fracture pressure, the fracture may take place and your slurry or the fluid, mud, will enter into the formation. You will lose this thing. Okay, fluid loss will take place. Okay, you will lose the mud. So this is how actually static you are displacing the cement slurry with the mud. Say, for example, it is 1.45. And in the LS, we have just now calculated what will be the density of the cement slurry with hematite slurry. It is 1.99. Suppose this much is the column, 600 meter is the column. Okay. And 300 meter. Total, what was the depth of the casing? It was 3000 something. Remember in my first slide, I illustrated 3000. But I am not concerned the upper portion above this 900 meter. Because why? Because in the outer LS as well as inside, the same mud is there. So I am not concerned. It will get neutralized. So I am only concerned with the 900 meter, this thing fluids. So hydrostatic head outside and inside, that I'll calculate. So it is, see, outside it is this, inside it. So differential pressure is how much it is coming. So it is coming 548 PSI is the differential pressure. So at the end, this is the differential pressure alone because of hydrostatic head, differential hydrostatic head, plus some pumping pressure because friction losses are also there when you are pumping. So the pumping pressure plus this will be the last pressure. Last pressures for this actually in the well, in the present case, will be of the order of around 650-700 PSI. If you are pumping fast, so it may be 800-900 PSI surface pressure. So minus friction losses in the LS, you calculate, it should be less than the hydrostatic head plus this ECD. ECD should be less than the fracture gradient, that we must take care. So that is, okay, how it is calculated is very simple. Hydrostatic head LS minus hydrostatic head here. So you calculate. So plus friction losses pumping. Okay. 9.5 HK, it is same. Okay. Only thing is additives are different. Here we have not added any of this thing. Here you can note down. Float collar depth is same again, 25 meter apart. Drill depth is this, and now 4 meter away we have kept this, 4 meter away. This is actual distance between the shoe and this 4 meter sum we have left. Float collar is 25 meter apart. And the casing here, casing is 958, 47 pounds per foot. NAT is the grade. We are not concerned about NAT P110. We are actually in cementing calculation is not required. Okay. This cement. But the thing is when we bump the plug, okay, we bump the plug. Bumping of the plug, it means we know that displacement is complete. I'll come to previous slide. Here, this is the differential pressure. So I need to ensure that the displacement is complete when this much pressure plus some maybe 400-500 PSI. So I'll bump the plug at 1000 PSI. So when I bump the plug, 1000 PSI is acting and inside, entire well inside. Okay, here is acting here also. So hoop stresses and the tensile load is generated against the casing when you bump the plug. Okay, that time if you see the check the hook load, it will be maximum. The tensile loads is generated here. Okay, so we need to take care of the tensile load also. It should not exceed, suppose casing is old and you are bumping, you are pressurizing excessively, you may actually damage the casing. Suppose your joint is not properly tightened. I have noticed that while bumping, the casing snap from the coupling. It snapped and hit this thing, crown block. It jumped while bumping the pressure. This actually is safety measures that we need to take. Actually, it just should be properly tightened. Another thing, yesterday I was telling we are using the plugs. So while lowering the casing, you need to rabbit it. Rabbit means go gauging has to be done. Suppose you are actually some casing pipe is not correct drift dia, drifting is not done, is above the drift dia, it is damaged casing. So what will happen, this plug will not pass. Bottom plug, there is no problem because it will rupture, it will rest against this damaged casing. Suppose the casing is less dia is there, suppose casing is like this. So the plug will not pass, this plug will get standard, but cement slurry will pass. But when the top plug will come here, it will rest again. So all the casing pipes have to be drifted. That is very important when you are lowering. If it is not drifted, any damaged pipe is lowered along with this thing, then you are stuck. You are nowhere. Casing will, cement will be remain inside. Okay. 9.58 inch casing. Now it is similar. I will exclude this. It's a similar this in calculation. 44% water. I'll displacement, float collar. I'll just move. Okay, 13.38, it is same, all different. Now, as I actually told you, either you can do dry blending or wet blending. In dry blending, you need to you get the result equivalent to 2% this wet blending. Okay, so suppose you are for the same result, you need you are doing dry blending, maybe we have to use 8%. So yield will be different. Okay, the slurry weight is same, 1.58, but you are required to add 8% bentonite, and water is this is also different, dry blending and wet blending. So it is always better to do wet blending. I mean pre-hydrate, that is called pre-hydrating. You need to add bentonite well in advance, minimum 30 minutes or preferably 4 to 5 hours before the cementation job. You mix in the tank, add the bentonite, allow it to pre-hydrate, then you add other additives. But all this is actually now 13C8. Now I'll be telling you this. This is actually, you see, this is a plug job calculations. I told yesterday, a plug is placed. What is cement plug? This is cement plug. This cement plug. Okay. And this green is pre, this is pre-flush, and this green is after flush. We actually calculate the calculation. Suppose I am required to place a plug of 100 meter inside the casing. Okay. So I know the capacity, this capacity. So 100 meter plug, when the pipe is out, so 100 meter volume, the capacity of the this thing in the first case, where the 5.5 inch casing, what was the capacity? It was 11.6 liter per meter. So suppose I am placing a plug inside 5.5 inch casing, 20 ppf. So for 100 meter plug, I am required to pump how much? 1.16 into 100, 11.6 into 100 will be 1.16 cubic meter cement slurry for 100 meter plug. Okay, capacity multiply by height of the plug will give you the total volume. Okay, slurry volume I know, that I'll pump. I have to know how much pre-flush or after flush has to be pumped. Suppose I decide that 200 meter, this thing, maybe 200 feet. 200 feet is about 70 something meter. Okay, 70 meter. Say, suppose I decide 70, 75 meter and height of pre-flush I'll pump. So I know this capacity, this annular capacity per meter I know. This capacity minus OD size of the drill pipe. Suppose I am using 5 inch drill pipe. So the OD is 5 inch or drill pipe. Okay. So 5 inch, this capacity I'll subtract, I know the annular capacity. So this capacity multiply by the height, I'll know the volume. I'll show you. So this is actually illustrated, this pipe is pulled out. Okay, when the pipe, I have to, suppose I designed to place a plug of 100 meter, when the pipe is inside, this pipe is inside. So the height of the plug will be more or less, it will be more, because metallic volume of this drill pipe will also be included. It will occupy, when the pipe is inside, it will occupy, the plug will occupy more height. In the cement, it will be of the order of maybe, not instead of 100 meter, it will be maybe 105, 110, okay, because this volume, solid volume of the drill pipe, this drill pipe volume, this thickness of the pipe is there, that has also to be included. Once it actually pulled out, this white, this metal volume, white, you are seeing strip, that is subtracted and will be 100 meter back again. So why I am concerned when the drill pipe is inside, when the drill pipe is inside, height of the plug, because see, when actually it occupies longer column, maybe instead in place of 100 meter, say it is occupying, the cement slurry is occupying 110 meter. So this 110 meter has to be subtracted, because up to this depth, I need to displace with the mud. This is the mud. Okay, I will illustrate maybe. Here I have actually, normally we don't use in the present case, it is actually, I have shown hematite used as the, normally hematite is generally not used in the plugs. Okay, this is a calculation. These are the additives and hematite, water is added. So for 100 meter plug, 5.5 inch casing, 1.16. Okay, 1.16 was the volume, and water requirement, it is 0.62. And hematite 16%. These are the additives, 0.8%. So these actually are calculated according to the percentage that is designed. Okay, material is there. Okay, additives. Okay, volume that is coming, one water volume. And see, this is actually the additives are coming. The water, mixed water. Suppose it is dry, wet blended additives. You are adding water. Water will has to be prepared extra because it will be prepared in the tank. So you need to prepare some extra water. Okay, so for the new extra water, we need to add more additives. Okay, suppose this in the previous calculation I am shown how much water will be required. So 1 cubic meter water will be prepared. Say 0.62 was my requirement of water, actual requirement. And instead of say 0.62, some extra water I prepare, 1 cubic meter I add. Suppose I prepare extra volume, maybe 1 cubic meter I prepare. So I will again calculate, reverse calculate this for 1 cubic meter according to the percentage that what will be the chemicals added. So all the chemicals will be added according to the 1 cubic meter, except dry blended. Suppose hematite is added, that is available in the cement. Okay, so that will not be added in the water, but all other additives, we have to be added in water. So when I'm preparing extra quantity of water, so all these actually have to be extra. Now you see, I was telling you how to this thing 50 meter. In this case, I have taken say 50 meter of pre-flush. So it is actually coming, this OD minus ID, this is actually showing 369 liter of pre-flush is coming. This volume is 369 liter. It will occupy a height of 50 meter between 5.5 inch casing and 5 inch drill pipe. So now this volume is fixed. So I will calculate now, because height of this should be same. So after flush should also be 50 meter. So as to the plug is exactly balanced. So for 50 meter, I know the capacity for 50 meter length. I know the capacity of the drill pipe, this capacity. Okay, therefore 50 meter, it is coming. If I calculate this, it is coming 151 liter. So I will pump 369 liter of water or spacer, whatever I am using as a pre-flush, and 151 liter of after flush. So that it is completely balanced. A slurry volume will be, it was some, what was this thing? 1 point something it was coming. It was 0.62 only, 0.62. Okay. So the volume of after flush is after placing the cement plug, tubing will be inside the cement. And hence, due to metallic volume, tubing head length of the plug will be more. So you see how much length of is coming. So this, what will be the height of the plug when the tubing or the pipe is inside? So the metal volume, so the volume of cement slurry divided by this capacity plus this capacity inside. So that is showing, see, 111 meter. So instead of 100 meter, it is coming 111.54 meter. So that depends on the which type of the tubing you are inside. Suppose in 5.5 inch casing, 5 inch drill pipe will not go. You cannot use either 2.78 inch tubing has to be used, or 3.5 inch. Not even 3.5 inch tool joint is more. Slightly will not be going. It will be 2.78 inch drill pipe or 2.3x18 drill pipe has to be used, or 2.78 inch tubing can be used. So this displacement will be done up to this. I have to subtract 111.54 meter. Not this. So total length will be this, and 50 meter was what? 50 meter was this height. So I will subtract this. I have to displace only up to this depth. So I displace how much? This depth minus this height. So it is this height, and to capacity of the 3.02 liter per meter is the capacity of 2.78 inch tubing. Okay, 6.5 ppf tubing is the capacity, is 3.02. So if you multiply, is the total liters. This is a 98 means total 9.825 cubic meter is the displacement volume. So many liters. Okay. So when you displace it slightly, actually I'm telling you along the calculation, slightly this has to be slowly rotated. So you will fit it on the top, and actually this tubing is rested on the slip, and you can rotate slowly you can rotate. Okay, so that the plug is actually placed balanced, because well may not be vertical. Slowly I'll explain tomorrow why it has to be done, how it actually affects. Okay, so this slowly it has to be rotated, so that actually this is uniformly placed, and then you pull out. Maybe this is plug is 110 meter inside when the drill pipe is there. So first maybe few stands, 3-4 stands you have to pull out very slowly. And what we do actually slightly we under displace, maybe by few liters. Why do we under displace? Because cement slurry is heavier than this. When actually this you under displace, the level of displacement will be here. So slightly the pressure of from inside will be slightly more. When you pull out, it will get stuck, and you may get some, maybe for initial stand, you may get a dry pull out, or will not be so much of any flow back, will not be there, and slowly it will fall down, cement will fall down. So by maybe a few liters, we actually under displace. That is actually operational requirement. But as theoretically, it has to be perfectly balanced. Okay. So this is actually pulled out. Now this is, we are inside what water or spacer. Now we'll pull out further and then reverse wash. Okay. And this is another example. Suppose that previous case, in the previous example, we were actually placing the cement plug inside the casing. Here, if suppose we have to place a plug partly inside open hole, or in this. So now here we have to calculate this volume. If a caliper log is available, then it's good. Say for in the present case 9.25 instead of 8.5-inch hole, the hole dia is 9.25. So it is more. So this dia through caliper we can check, or with experience, suppose caliper is not available. So with experience we have ki how much caving will be there. Normally the caving just below the shoe is maximum. In most of the cases, so it is shown less, but it will be like this. It will be like this, very large volume just below the shoe. So okay, here also calculation is same. Metal volume has to be calculated. It is displaced. Okay, you can see the slide if it is available now. Same plug. Only thing is see, because volume here, this volume has to be calculated separately from this volume. Principle is same. Metal volume plus this volume plus this volume. Okay, so because capacity below the shoe of the hole is different than that of this thing casing, so you have to calculate this displacement plug height and volume separately. Okay, now this casing, another check, when you especially when your large casings are lowered, say 20 inch or bigger than 20 inch casing, and it has say fitted with the shoe, an RV it is fitted, then what happens, as I told you, this will be covered suppose up to the surface. We are taking cement slurry, and cement slurry is heavy, maybe 1.9 ppg if we need cement we are using up to surface. So we need to check for floating of the casing. Okay, other suppose what happens, because density of the fluid outside is what cement slurry is, will be there, it is in liquid form when it is displaced, and inside is the lighter fluid, that is mud. And in the initial casing, when a large casing size is used, mud weight may be what equivalent to water, maybe 1.1, and the slurry weight is 1.9. So what will happen, because of buoyancy, excessive buoyancy, the casing may float. Casing may float because up thrust will act because of buoyancy, so it may float. So if actually you notice such a condition, we need to tie with the clamps at the surface, okay, and design accordingly. Okay, so this has to be checked for cementation, floating, lifting of the casing, especially large casing. And you can do the calculation. It's nothing, it's very simple. It is according to the Archimedes principle is applied. Total force downward minus total upward force, up thrust. Then you calculate the load of weight of the casing. We know, say it is 20 inch casing, then it will be either 94 pound per feet or 133 pound per feet. So we know the total weight. we know the total buoyancy because of the cement slurry. So if the thrust is more, so there is a chances of lifting of casing. Now, a very important test is carried out. Have you heard of leak off test? It's actually done by cementing engineers using cementing unit at the rigs. So it is very important. Why LOT is recorded leak off test? It is done to know when you have to drill the well further, drill the next section. Suppose I have lowered the 9.58 inch casing. Now my next section will be 8.5 inch hole. So at 9.58 inch shoe, when I drill the shoe, I check the shoe integrity. Then after once it is ensured that the shoe is okay, I drill further. I drill a fresh formation, maybe 2 to 5 meter fresh formation. I drill, okay. Then after drilling the formation, I carry out the LOT leak off test of the formation. Because it is actually presumed as you go deeper, formations are more embedded because of overburden pressure. And since suppose these formations are not depleted, then you will the LOT value will actually increase as you go down. Okay. So shoe is the weakest point. Shoe is the weakest point. And this LOT is very, very important for well control process also, well control. Because if well, if any activity occurs, so you have to calculate the mass. Mass is maximum allowable annular pressure. So if actually, if you exceed the mass, the loss will take place at the shoe or maybe somewhere else in between. So the shoe being, we presume the shoe is the weakest point. So we calculate LOT leak off test. That is very important. How it is done in cementing, using cementing unit, we pump the volumes, required volume, fixed volume, small quantities as you can measure, maybe quarter barrel, and then you pump quarter barrel and see how much is the pressure is increasing. Okay. So it initially you plot this in different point, half barrel, then you pump again for half barrel like that. And you notice the pressure, how much increasing. A point will come when the formation will start just leaking. So it will not leak completely. This is actually this drop. If you plot the graph, it will be more or less straight line, more or less straight line, join all the points. And when it actually just bends this point, this is the leak off value. And here, saying stop, there may be actually, we may go up to fracture. This is actually, you are actually losing the mud this year because the pressure has dropped drastically. So here, this leak off is considered. So you know what is the pressure. Here, I'll show you. So that pressure is noted down. That is what? Surface pressure. Because that pressure is, I am observing at the cementing unit, pumping unit. That pressure is, I am applying from the surface by keeping the BOP closed. In the drill string with the bit only, it is actually, LOT is taken. You drill it, you actually, after drilling a fresh formation, you come back to the shoe, close the BOP, circulate properly, mud should become homogeneous if any cutting is there. So it will create ambiguity, that it will not give you the correct hydrostatic pressure. So it has to be circulated thoroughly. And once the mud is homogeneous, you check the mud weight, note down the mud weight. Okay, outcoming mud weight and ingoing mud weight should be same. And then you close BOP and pump mud in small increments. Okay, close small increments and plot the graph and take the LOT. Suppose at this point, this leak off value. So this pressure we need to note. This is a surface pressure. So at what pressure is exerted in the closed condition? Because you are not pumping, you are not circulating. Hydrostatic head plus this surface pressure is, you calculate this, this pressure, surface pressure plus hydrostatic head of the mud weight you have noted. So that hydro total pressure will give you the LOT. So hydrostatic acid plus surface pressure plus that you have to consider TVD, because for hydrostatic head, we have to consider true vertical depth only, not measured depth. Okay. So that will give you the LOT value. So this will be in pressure and we can convert it by dividing in by a TVD to mud weight equivalent. So I have actually in red, it is TVD. Well is inclined. So there is a difference of about 47 meter. So we have to consider this red, this thing, 255 meter, this thing. Mud weight, we know, LOT. So this LOT is calculated, mud weight plus this hydrostatic head of mud is coming about 370 KSE. Then surface pressure, because say it is 1100 PSI, I have to convert into KSE. So divided by 14.22 is the conversion factor. 14.22 PSI per KSE. So you divide it, it is converted. You add this with this and multiply with the this. And what is this? Is TVD 2551. So you get mud weight equivalent. So in no case, even in static condition, your mud weight should exceed 1.75. But in dynamic condition, it means ECD should, in no case, ECD at shoe should exceed 1.75. This is the limit. Okay. And this is very, very, very useful, very, very useful in well control. Okay. So now I'll come to this thing, how we calculate the critical velocity. Yesterday I told you this critical velocity we have to displace in turbulence. This is actually turbulence. When the Reynolds number is more than 2,800, and some people say 3,000, so it will be actually, you'll be displacing in critical velocity. This is actually turbulence flow. This is laminar flow. And another flow is called plug flow. Plug flow is very, 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 very slow rate, very slow rate. So normally actually we don't displace in plug flow. We do not carry out job. So either we do it in turbulence, or if actually turbulence is not achievable, then we do higher side of the laminar. So discharge rate should be higher, okay, as far as possible. But in no case, we should exceed the fracture gradient in any case. So this is actually the formula. So this is critical velocity. But normally for cementing engineers, this is calculated by the lab. We have actually calculated, we get the critical velocity for a particular hole size, slurry design, because it depends on the flow, so many parameters of this actually, okay. Flow criteria, I'll show you. And normally this this flow, cement slurry, there are three models used in power law model, Wickham model, in mud also use this thing. But there is another mixed model, that is normally cement follows this. For cement slurries, we use follow this model, Herschel-Buckley model, Herschel-Buckley. Because Bingham is a linear, this thing, it is not, it is only for simplicity, for simplification of calculations we use normally. Bingham plastic model is neither used in mud, only for calculation and comparison purpose we actually use it. Otherwise, linear this thing is not possible. Normally, mud actually follows this power law fluid model, power law model. And this cement slurries, this model is followed. Now, these are actually, I have explained, you can see the slide, you can study also, perhaps you might have studied in theoretical class also, what is actually K dash flow indices number on this power law, this K dash and N dash that you maybe was with. So this I'm showing you typical, this is a typical ONGC's slurry report. So in the slurry design report, whether it is by ONGC or because API standard is there, so all companies, Halliburton, Schlumberger, they actually report all this. The format may be slightly different, but parameters are same. So in this actually we use the composition it is showing. Say cement 100%, water 44%, silica is actually 5% they have used. Thickening time, these are additive. So thickening time, I explained what is thickening time. So this actually conditions, what is a bottom hole circulating pressure and temperature. Pressure is 4,150 and temperature is 62 degrees centigrade. And the RT is what? Time to raise. Because the slurry, when you mix at the surface, you pump it. And when the slurry, when will the temperature go? When the slurry will be in the endless, then only the temperature will go up. So time to raise is maybe 30 minutes, 40 minutes, 50, depending upon the depth and the well condition, at what rate you are pumping. So, okay. So 40 minutes here, we have taken this time to raise is 30 minutes. Means this temperature, circulating temperature in the consistometer, we are raising this temperature in 30 minutes. Okay. And actually we are giving break also. Break is what? Because when I will tell you tomorrow, when I'll explain about the consistometer, actually it is in motion. The slurry remains in motion, but when it becomes static, if you have too many breaks, you stop the slurry, so the thickening time reduces. Thickening time will not remain same. So there should be minimum breaks. So, but you are required to drop the plug. So, or if anything, any happens, you stop for a while, their slurry may not be in motion. So it becomes static. So we give the break for 10 minute, 15 minute break. Okay. So after what? So during raising time, it cannot be given. When it is placed, after 40 minutes, here it, a break is given. So here you see in the green, N dash and K dash values have been given. Even critical velocity is also calculated. It is calculated, is given, okay, to the operating people. So we did not calculate it because formulae are very, very complex. Actually, you apply this in the formulae and then you get this VC, critical velocity. Here in this case, it is 9.4 feet per second, and low velocity. So again, if I know this critical velocity, it means to achieve turbulence of this size of hole, 3-inch dia, inless dia, okay. So this is a 7-inch liner. 7-inch liner is a 1.5-inch clearance will be there. For this is required is so much of velocity is required, 9.4 feet this thing. And this 7-inch liner is lowered against 8.5-inch hole. So in against 8.5-inch hole, this much is feet per second velocity is required in the endless to achieve turbulence. So turbulence, minimum this much. If it exceeds, then okay. But I have to see the limit that I'll come. Limits means limits are what? If I pump too fast, the ECD may increase and breakdown of formation may occur. So I need to achieve this. So I need to optimize. This I have to achieve to 9.4. So correspondingly, because I know the velocity, I know the capacity of endless. So at what rate I have to pump the discharge rate? I can calculate. I can calculate discharge rate because velocity, okay, this velocity in the endless, I know the volume is per discharge. I know discharge is what? Volume per second. Volume per second, and this is feet per second. I know the annular capacity. If I divide this, actually, annular capacity is, I know the discharge rate. So this is actually known. Now, another is actually predicting this bottom hole temperature gradient. Temperature thermal gradient is what? Per 100 meter or 100 feet, how much actually as you go deeper, temperature increases. And some abnormalities also occur. Normally what happens is against the limestone, slightly temperatures are higher. Okay, so it is not exactly in all fields. Some actually we have high HPHT wells where temperatures are abnormally high. Abnormal temperatures are also observed. Okay, some activities, geological activities take place, so the temperatures are higher. But thermal gradients, so different thermal gradients are there. So per this thing 100 feet, this can be calculated, and so that we can predict bottom hole circulating temperature, because slurry is designed as per bottom hole circulating temperature, and the strength is calculated because slurry is strength is calculated when the cement is set. So cement is set, then it is calculated at bottom hole static temperature. Okay, and this 27 degree centigrade we have presumed the ambient temperature at the surface. Okay, so gradient will be bottom hole static temperature minus this. And how do you get bottom hole static temperature? That static temperature is available when you record the log. Suppose when you record resistivity log, temperature must be recorded. So, okay, the logger also depends how many hours this thing circulation was stopped. So, if it is recorded after 24 hours, 30 hours, it means that has attained static temperature. Okay, that depends because what is the thermal transfer, mud type of mud, steel, and this thing, all well conditions, size, etc. So many conditions actually depend. But we know the static temperature. So, against that, we put this static temperature value here so that we can find the temperature gradient. So against the temperature gradient system. Okay. One moment, there was a slide. Okay. So with that, if we know the gradient, we can calculate the bottom hole circulating temperature. Okay, perhaps this one slide is missing. Perhaps it is. Okay. Now this I am explaining you how the pressure is actually acting when you are squeezing jaw. Hesitation by hesitation method. Hesitation is actually when the formation is taking cement slurry very easily. Then we pump, stop for a while, then again pump, stop for a while. So actually we build the nodes and the pressure increases. So desired, whatever we have planned, this thing desired pressure limit, say in this case, it is say 2000 PSI that we want to achieve. But initially when I pump it, mixing it, see it is going down. Why it is going down? The slurry is traveling in the drill pipe. So because of U-tubing, the pressure will come down first. But when it is again, it is rising. It is rising. Why it is rising? When the slurry will start rising into the annulus, it will give a back pressure. Okay, pressure differential. So that will increase. It is increasing cement entering formation. Okay, this is now entered. Okay, now this has now become straight. Now it is level. Now I apply. Now I close the BOP. I pump some slurry. Then it drops down. It goes into pressure. It will drop. Then again I apply pressure. It comes to sink. Now slightly, if you see the nodes, slowly, slowly it is higher and higher pressure because the nodes are formed against the perforation, some cement, and it loses water. And slightly it attains some strength. Maybe after 5-10 minutes, 15 minutes, I divide the thickening time of the slurry into number of attempts that I'll make. Okay, suppose maybe here we have made 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 hesitations we have made. So 7 times we pumped, pressure dropped, pump, drop. So each times higher and higher pressure got in. Finally, till finally this 2000 PSI was attempt. Then we bled off the pressure. Then after some time, we actually test it. Test the squeeze, now it is holding 2000 pressure. Because it was holding here, so most likely this will hold here. So it will be done. Normally, we can test it here, but after drilling the cement, we have to test it. When you test the hermeticity, so it we have to test it at 2000 PSI. Okay. So I think it got pasted. Now, this is actually nowadays, we are using simulators and the programs, it is all programs are there. This is SEMCAD, it's Schlumberger program. So this is actually, it tells us, this simulator tells us, all the data is fed, we feed the data, mud parameters, IP, YP value, plastic viscosity, mud density, and the circulation rate, everything is fed in the system. And then we get the, in return, cement slurry also, weight, everything is fed. How much time we have circulated, all the data is there, fed. And when the rates, displacement rates, etc. are pumped, so we get the simulated. So we get this, you are seeing this, this is red is hydrostatic head. This is simple hydrostatic head, okay, here. And this is minimum dynamic. Why dynamic condition? Because it considers the ECD, so dynamic values. This will be hydrostatic, it will be more than that. So the green is actually this. So, but it is coming between, this is actually fracture gradient. As you go deeper, it is showing slant, it is bottom, it is more. So, but in, and this is pore pressure. This is pore pressure. So our all the time, the pressure should be between pore pressure and fracture limit. So here it is well within this. So it is actually, see, it is increasing. Now it is somewhat static. So this is actually, it is within. So now it is safe. So the pumping rate is also made available. Then, and it is showing this wellhead pressure. Wellhead pressure means pumping pressure. Okay. Wellhead pressure. This pump pressure, this is actually, see this plot, and it is also the maximum pressure we can know what will be the ANCA as we actually calculated. So the friction rate at which we are pumping, so we can suggest at what rate, what suppose this ECD, this line is, say, is very close to our this, or somewhere it is crossing, suppose it is touching somewhere. So it means I need to slow down the pumping rate. So the simulator also, we can plan what volume, which volume we have to pump at what rate. Okay. So that is actually, we are simulating, and yeah, now it is actually over. Thank you very much. Now, do you have any questions? Hello? Have any questions, participants?
Hello, good evening, sir.
Good evening.
Sir, you said we pump mud in the LOT, but we use cementing unit. So, sir, why this, like, we can't use mud pump for pumping mud?
See, mud pump, what happens? You can do it, but see, what cementing, because plunger size is very accurate. You can pump to very accurate volumes. If you measure the LOT value with the mud pump, because what is the liner size? 6.5 inch, 7 inch, 6 inch, like that. Okay. And exact volume you cannot monitor, because tanks you will be sucking where, from where? From the main tanks. Maximum smallest tank available in the drilling series, slug pit. where the volume is 10 cubic meter. Whereas this our we have calibrated, we can pump quarter barrel also. We can measure because our displacement tank volume is much less, so we can accurately pump. Okay, that is why actually we do it. We can have a better control. Small volumes can be pumped. And suppose your LOT value is very high, so with the pump you may not get it because your limit may reach. Got it?
Yes, sir. Thank you.
Okay. Any other question? Yes, participants, please ask questions. Hello,
sir. Hello, sir. One more doubt. Sir, yes. As in leak of test, like you said, we make the fracture sort of. We initiate a fracture.
No. We do not initiate fracture. I never said that. See, if you see the curve, that if actually we pump it and when the slight volume is actually taken by. If you fracture the formation, then it will be difficult. Fracturing is done, pumping extended LOT. Nowadays, actually extended LOT is taken. Okay. So there also you do not fracture completely, only pump extra mud. But here the LOT value is when the formation just starts taking small volume. It is there will be slight drop. That point is LOT.
Okay, sir, got it. Thank you.
Yeah. Next, any question,
sir?
Yes.
Sir, you said in some cases we'll consider Herschel-Buckley model, and some cases we'll consider Power-Love.
Normally what cement actually follows, cement is actually very complex in its consistency. That is why we do not measure this in terms of PVYPs, because it keeps changing. So normally cement follows, in cementation we follow this Hushlet model, and in mud we follow power law for simplicity, some calculation and comparison purpose also, because along with the cement, mud is also flowing. Because ahead of cement, it is mud. So comparison is done. This Bingham plastic model is really actually, does it work in most of, because most of the even mud system, it does not work. It is not applicable. Only for comparison purpose. You have Newtonian, is any Newtonian fluid is there? But what is the basic fluid? Water is nearly a Newtonian fluid. So that is Newtonian fluid, because it, if you plot the graph between YP at this, when you see this, it is zero. Smallest of these things, stress is applied, actually it starts moving. That is the Newtonian fluid, no? It's water. So that is only for comparison purpose. Normally, actually, we do not follow this, only for comparison. Okay. Because cement slurries are very complex and okay. Hmm.
Okay.
Yes. Yeah.
Hello, sir.
Yes. Yeah.
While doing LOT test, they are measuring the pressure. So where they are keeping the gates, sir? Actually, from where?
Since I am pumping at the cementing unit, from the cementing unit, I have a gauge available at the unit at the console. I can watch the system. I have closed the LOT. Okay, when I'm pumping into the string, drill string. Okay, at the pump pressure is what? It is the surface gauge pressure that will show the pumping pressure.
Okay, sir. So what is the starting at the starting point?
Instead of starting point, it is, see, you saw the curve, it is starting from zero. The water, yes, sir, will also not pump, pressure will also be zero.
Okay, sir.
Okay. So because when I start, pressure is zero, only when I have stopped circulation, is there any pressure? Only hydrostatic is acting against the formation, isn't it?
Yes, sir.
When I close the BOP and start pumping, then the surface pressure will start acting on this. Mud will get compressed. It will go to a compress and I'm increasing pressure slowly. When I'm pumping volume and it is not coming out, BOP is closed, it means pressure is increasing. That is what it is reflected on my gauge. A stage will come when the mud will just start. Slope will change. So that point is LOT value. So that pressure I need to know. Only after plotting. So, yeah.
Sir, at the starting point, will the mud be full inside the borehole, sir? So at yes, the start,
it has to be full. It has okay. to be, what I told you. First, you drill the fresh formation, because if you are not drilling fresh formation, so in the suppose rat hole, so the hole which was cemented when the casing was lowered, so there may be some cement against the formation. It will not give you the correct LOT value, because fresh formation is not exposed. By noting LOT, what you are measuring? You are measuring the checking the strength of the formation, not cement. So suppose cement is okay. So as shoe integrity test is done, then you drill a fresh formation. So after drilling fresh formation, some cuttings are generated. So that cuttings have to be removed from the hole. Otherwise, what will cuttings are loaded in the LS? The hydrostatic will it not? Because of cuttings present. So cuttings have to be removed. I told you, you have to check the mud weight. Outcoming mud weight and the ingoing mud weight should be same. Once it becomes homogeneous, then you stop circulation, you close the BOP, and then from the cementing unit, the present mud that is you are using, because okay, active mud. That active mud will you start pumping slowly in quarter barrel and note down the pressure. That is how that is recorded. Yes.
Sir, but the thing is, actually, since it is a closed form, closed pack, actually, half barrel, it won't take, na, sir.
It will take. See, listen, this is when the well is there, you, when we do hermetical testing, okay, hermetical testing, water is present, water is inside with the hermetical testing. A water is nearly incompressible, but it takes some volume. To increase the pressure from 0 to maybe 500 psi, we pump maybe 1 barrel, 2 barrel, depending upon the depth and the size of the casing. If the casing size is bigger, we need to pump more volume. Okay.
Okay, sir.
Even if you have some this thing cylinder or you press it, even if it is closed, some this thing is compressible. Now it is actually get compressed, and mud is also maybe somewhat compressible. Somewhat. Yeah. We need to check, yeah.
So it will take some amount, sir?
A small amount it will take. Because when you pump it, what we are doing, when you pump it, pressure will increase.
Yes,
sir. We are not able to take, pressure will increase. That is exactly what is happening. Mm-hmm. You take a syringe, you close the mouth of the syringe, you press it, it means you are increasing the pressure. Same thing, mm-hmm. Well is closed. Okay, but at some point, because it is not steel, we are exposed to the formation, it will take mud. When we just start taking mud, that is what we are measuring, the pressure we are measuring. You pump mud, pressure will increase. You pump small quantity, again pressure will increase. And when you bleed it, you see the nearly entire, that volume has also to be calculated. I forgot to mention, when you are complete with the test, you actually bleed it and take how much return of mud has come. You will notice that nearly entire volume has come back. Got it?
Yes, sir.
Yes.
Thank
you. Yes. Yeah. Any other question from other participants? Hello, Jayant?
Yes, sir, I'm here.
Yes. Any questions from anybody?
Students, if you have any questions, you can clear your doubt.
Today also now many participants have left. Only 29 are there, including me.
Sir, is there any rule is there like for this much pressure, this much amount of water will get compressed? Like there is there any?
Yes.
Sir, is there any rule is there like for this amount of pressure, like the this much cubic volume of water can be compressed, like that is there?
See, when you are actually compressing the fluid, maybe small quantity of air may be present in the mud, it's not a clear fluid, okay? In water also, what happens when you apply the pressure? So it depends on the size of the casing. Suppose I am carrying out hermetical test in 9.5-inch casing. Because 9.5-inch casing is a bigger size, volume will also be more. So it will take more volume. And the strength of the casing, because when I apply pressure, it actually tries to, will it not bulge out? It is steel, but it will bulge out, maybe in microns only it will bulge out. When you apply 500, 700 PSI pressure, will it not bulge out? smaller is the size, less it will bulge out. Bigger is the size of the casing, more it will bulge out. So slightly, even if it the increase in the bulging out is in microns, even then it will have some volume. Microns multiply by depth of the casing, so it will take some volume.
Okay, sir. Oh, so even
so,
elongation also has to be taken into
account. Yes, see, elongation, of course, slight elongation also is all taken. If you are recording, say when you are doing suppose you hang the casing and are actually pressurizing the casing, when you bump the plug, you check the dielometer, the load of the casing will get reduced because of the tension. Because I told you, when it can get snapped, I give an example,
Yes, sir. Thank you, sir. Thank
yes.
You.
Now, any other question?
Sir, actually, in hesitation, actually, in order to selectively cement a certain zone, how we have to carry out that
function? What?
Selectively cement a particular perforation like that.
So what we do, suppose against the perforation you want to squeeze or you want to place a plug against that, what we lower the drill pipe or tubing up to that slurry is pumped and it is displaced up to that depth. So where will it, the cement will be against the perforation, will it not be?
So how can we isolate the annulus, sir? Because stops it will...
No. See, unless we open... No, see... Come back, I'll show you the slide. Perhaps you are not understanding. Say this case.
Okay, sir.
Okay. This annulus is open. If it is, will I be able to pump it? I pump this water. Then I pump the slurry. It will be coming down. You see, it is coming down. The next slide, you see? This is after flush. Yesterday also, I demonstrated in the scene. So this is now complete. This is open. This should be open. This is actually wrongly shown. This is closed. It's not closed. It is open. You are circulating. It is coming out. You are pumping through the tubing or drill pipe. And it is coming from inside, it's coming out, and that is coming out like that. So you pump the required quantity and displace in such a way so that the cement comes, suppose perforation is here. So the cement comes against this here, this. Displacement is done in such a way. And the volume is calculated for this much of volume is calculated. We know the capacity, suppose 100 meter is there, so 100 meter we calculate.
Okay, sir. Sir, if we are using dump piler, so how it is, sir?
Dump piler. Do you have any idea about dump baler? It is actually dump baler is lowered with the wire line. Okay. Dump baler with small quantity is not obsolete, it is not used nowadays. Dump baler, you only a small quantity of slurry can be sent down this thing where you do not have the string or this thing, it will go down and only at a particular, there will not be any contamination. But very small quantity dump baler will be opened and then it will dump there and then you will pull out the dump baler. It's a mechanical way of putting. But here, hydraulically, we are mixing the slurry. But there is a dump baler, you is obsolete now. It is not used, rarely used dump baler. Where did you hear about dump
baler? Actually, I saw in a Rabia book, sir, so that's why I just asked.
Right. But Rabia is very old, this thing, ruling book. Okay, nowadays, actually, it is becoming obsolete. Nobody uses it. In my life, I tell you, I have a 35-year plus experience, but I never used dump baler in my life.
Okay, sir.
But I also know, theoretically, I know it's run with the wire line. Because at a particular, suppose it is very complex, or this thing pumping with the through drill pipe is not possible, then dump baler, you can only at a particular spot, you know, because when you run the dump baler with the wire line, so you can precisely you can dump, but very small quantity can be pumped. And when it is dump baler dumping it, then also slurry will get contaminated with the mud, which is present, or the fluid which is present in the well. Yeah.
Okay. Yes. One last question, can I ask?
Yes, please ask as many as you.
Sir, actually, in a work over operation, so if you are performing any secondary cementing job, so is it necessary to kill a well, sir?
Your question is, for any cement job, you need to kill the well?
No, sir. If any work over operation has to be done, like...
It is done. Yesterday I told that for water shutoff. Water shutoff is done in work over only. Okay, zone transfer is done in workover only, zonal transfer, it is done in workover. So all these things are done in workover only.
Okay, sir.
So you can place, you can squeeze the job, you can isolate, and once the life of the well is over, or if it conclusively testing is done and the well goes dry, then also we are required to place the plug, abundant plug, 3 permanent. Yesterday I demonstrated 3 plugs placed, abundant plug. So plugs are given, plugs can be given. So what is your question in the workover regarding plug? It is done, can be, either you can use the plug or you can do squeeze jobs.
Okay, so the thing is actually, so if in order to shut off water producing zone or a gas producing zone, so
yes.
Since it is a producing well, I have to first kill the well and then I have to do a cementing process.
Of course, for any operations to be carried out, you need to balance it. Okay. Killing means, okay, balance it. The formation which is exposed against the proportion, it has to be balanced. Otherwise, what will happen? Their activity, what suppose the intrusion of water or the gas takes place, it will spoil it. I already told you, it has to be in all cases, in all this thing operations, this hydrostatic head or the ECD should be more than the pore pressure and less than the fracture gradient. In all cases.
Sir, is there any possibility
yes.
that the hydrostatic column of fluid might enter into the formation and...
If you exceed it, it will definitely enter.
So,
normally our actually hydrostatic head is overbalanced condition we do it, normally. So, and when you are doing squeeze job, it is definitely overbalanced. And if our intention is to squeeze, it means our intention is we plan to... plan that the cement slurry goes into the formation. That is our objective. Otherwise, how will you repair it? If you balance it, only balance, that is placing the plug. You come out and wash it and the plug will set. But when you are required to drill it and you want to squeeze the cement, squeezing means applying pressure and enter cement slurry into the, forcing cement slurry into the formation. That is...
Thank you, sir. I got it, sir. Thank you so much.
Yeah, please. Okay, you can raise. Any other question? Jen?
Yes, sir. Hello, sir.
Yes, Jen.
When we use the cement retainer during cementing job?
Cement retainer. Okay. Very, very, very nice question. Very nice question. See, suppose you have a casing leak. Okay. And suppose you have a casing leak at a place and we need to carry out the job. Okay.
Okay.
Casing is, say, very old. I'm just giving an example. Casing is very old. And the required squeeze pressure is much higher than the casing strength itself. Yesterday I explained. Nah? So suppose I actually do a normal cement plug job and apply pressure. How I carry out conventional squeeze job? By closing BOP and applying pressure.
Pressure.
Isn't it? So when I do that, entire well is pressurized.
Oh.
Well is pressurized. So, and when I do the retainer job, the casing below the retainer will only be pressurized because I am using a stabbing tool, a stringer, and a running tubing or drill pipe. So drill pipe or tubing will be pressurized, but not the casing. You got it? Because it's a packer.
Oh, yes.
So the casing will be pressurized below the retainer and some pressure that will be transmitted. And sometimes we actually, I did not cover the block cementation because it's slightly is advanced. So block cementation also is done. Cement retainer is placed above the lower perforation and perforation is done above the retainer and the stringer is stabbed in and we actually establish circulation behind the casing. So we actually cover both the zones. Okay.
Oh, yeah, yes.
So that okay. In those cases, actually, we carry out.
Okay, understood.
Sir, if possible, can you share your email ID so that is there if any doubt?
You can actually through you know Jan.
Yes, sir. I'll be sharing your mail ID.
Please talk to Jan. They will forward me the question. I'll reply. Any question? Any on cementation or?
Yeah. Even you can just mail us to the
email. Or anything about the group.
You can just text out your particular inquiries, and we are here to solve your doubts. And we'll just forward it to the store, and so will be.
Okay. So these fellows who are this thing organizers, I will give them. You can speak to me. Okay. There's any more question for now? Any more questions?
And the recording session will also
be. Did you understood what I told? Because it's on through slides is difficult to explain. But I tried to do justice. You understood? Most of you?
Yes, sir. Yes, we understood.
Okay. So even if 50% you can remember, you can understand. So you can go through the literature or the whatever your test books, and you can definitely, because everything is not possible for students to understand. I can visualize because I am experienced, so I can keep on speaking, thinking that because I there is no eye contact also. No, I am showing presentation, so I don't know where to stop, where to speak. So I just keep continuing. And this is my second. It's yesterday only, first time I took lecture on this online.
Actually, I was kept on struggling more than 2 years with that LOT data, sir. Actually, I couldn't able to understand how the pressure is increasing, but now I got a clear picture of about what you said.
Okay. Thank you very much. Yes, if you have any future doubt in future also, you can contact me. I'll try to explain.
Okay, sir. That's why I asked you a mail ID.
Okay. I'll actually share it.
Thank you, sir.
Okay. Thank you. Jan?
Yes, sir. Yes, I'm here.
Or any question?
No, sir.
It's okay. Now we can stop.
Yes, sir.
So we'll join tomorrow again. Okay. Maybe I'll try to this thing please, because a lot of things have to be covered. If I just think in between also, I'll say this is there. So but really I also jump some one to this thing other, because I sometimes I feel I should have told this thing, but I forget it. I have not even brushed through the slides. Okay, it happens. So anyway, tomorrow a lot of things are there. And all our things are interrelated. So in such a small time, because if I want to cover everything on cementing, so I need to take maybe 10 days lecture, minimum 10 days. Okay. So I have to look at this. But these things are, some of these things are available in textbook, but my experience is there, so I can share. It is more important to have interactive section. If you raise more queries, your doubts will be cleared. These things actually you can see. This may be in some slides now also. Okay, now shall we stop? Shall we conclude? Okay.
Yes, sir. Conclude this.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you, everybody. Thank you for
being participants.
Thank you, sir. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Okay, welcome.